vagrancy statutes dictated that in every southern state, you were a criminal if you could not prove employment. These laws created a large shift. By the end of Reconstruction, only 10% of those arrested were white.
Prisons in the South placed prisoners with industries that paid for guarding and lodging in exchange for labor. This system was called convict leasing, which brought in new, unexpected revenue for southern states. In 1874, the first year of convict leasing in Alabama, that state made $14,000 in revenue. By 1890, that number increased to $164,000, the equivalent of about $4.1 million today.
Walk shadowy indifference that resides in the hushed folds of our hearts, never seeking to illuminate the gray hall in which our excuses and forgettings lie. Prisoners were imprisoned for trivial or vague crimes, Nearly 90% of those held were black. Concurrently, by 1890, white voters reversed many of the civil rights gains afforded to blacks during Reconstruction, including revoking the right to vote, limiting funding for black schools, and mandating segregation. Because the United States officially did not want to adopt the Mexican system of debt slavery called peonage, Congress passed an anti-peonage law in 1867. Despite this, peonage was also used as a tactic to ensnare many poor, innocent blacks in the South. Peonage in the United States officially ended in 1966 under President Johnson.
On April 9, 1921, John S. Williams was convicted by an all-white jury for the murders of 11 black men who were enslaved in peonage. Williams was the first white man since 1877 to be indicted for first-degree murder of a black man. It would not happen again until 1966.
In the 75 years following the Civil War, the 4 million poor whites throughout the country became the 40 million middle-class whites by the middle of World War II. This was done in a way that simultaneously excluded and brutalized black people.
As Khalil Muhammad, the director of the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture in Brooklyn, stated, "We have to recognize that in these awful, ghastly tales of the brutalization of black people in this country, the motivation for that was profit, from small landowners to major corporations. So at the end of the day, that part of this country's legacy is still with us."
We have to recognize that in these awful, ghastly tales of the brutalization of black people in this country, the motivation for that was profit, from small landowners to major corporations. So at the end of the day, that part of this country's legacy is still with us.
As scholar Adam Green stated, without the appreciation of this history, you descend into fantasies that black people don't deserve equal rights because black people constitutionally, intellectually, and morally are not the equals of whites, period.
Of this history, you descend into fantasies that black people don't deserve equal rights because black people constitutionally, intellectually, and morally are not the equals of whites, period.